All right, so today we're going to be going through some of the video art from the exhibition. And Paul has put together a compilation for me of 2-minute clips for each of the videos that we have. I know yesterday we had a chance to watch Jim Mendiola's video, which I also have in here. So when we get to that one, we can maybe take a vote, see if y'all want to watch those first 2 minutes again, or we can skip through it and just talk about the video. So first I'm going to start off with just a very brief overview of video art in the 1990s. And so in the 1990s, with the emergence of the World Wide Web, cable television, mobile phones, all of these different things that we're able to share images on and look at images on, we really come into this decade where visual culture and images dominate. And so some of the art historians of that period, notably Gottfried Boehm and W.J.T. Mitchell, they actually coined the term the pictorial turn in the 1990s, in the early 90s. And art critic Rosalind Krauss introduced the idea of the visual turn in her 1996 essay, Welcome to the Cultural Revolution. Also, video art came into the art world in the 1960s and 1970s. So it's not new to the decade, the 90s, but what we see in the 90s is that video equipment that was previously really large, cumbersome, and expensive, also difficult to use. You had to know a lot about the technical side of video. Yesterday, Jim Mendiola was talking about how he used 16 millimeter film and how he decided to go with a voiceover because he otherwise would have had to match up the sound to the film. But in the 1990s, we see technological advances that allow for cheaper equipment that is more accessible, it's lightweight, and it also makes it so much easier to make videos. It's interesting because people at the time kind of referred to it as this real-time video that they were able to produce, which now we have a totally different perspective on since we're able to do Facebook Live and those types of things. But it's really during that period that we... So previously in the 60s and 70s, it was mostly American artists who made video art, but then in the 90s, we start to see that artists from all across the world, from different backgrounds, and particularly younger artists, are starting to use this medium. There's also a lot of artists who are trained in sculpture who come into working with video art, and they take a more sculptural approach to the medium by using tube TVs to create assemblages and that sort of thing, which we don't have represented in Fashion Nirvana since those are all projections, but it definitely was very much a thing of that period. And video played a central role in expanding the art world of the 1990s. Popular culture, as it was seen on television and in the music industry, was no longer seen as the enemy, but as an integral part of the creative imagination. And we see that in almost all of the videos that are represented in Fashion Nirvana, that they're looking at popular culture for inspiration. It's not always a critique of popular culture, but just something that is existing around them that they're taking influence from. All right, so we'll get started with the first video. And I'm gonna do this by just giving you all a little setup, then we can watch the clip. And then afterwards, if y'all have any questions, or if you have comments on the video too, if there's something about the setting, the mood, the tone, I would love to hear your thoughts on it too. And we can kind of brainstorm how this might be approached for a tour and those kinds of things. So the first video that we're gonna watch, we're taking a chronological approach. So the earliest video we have in the exhibition is a video by John Sanborn and Mary Perillo. And it's made in collaboration with Bill T. Jones. This video is from 1989. The time frame for the exhibition is 1989 to 2001. And John Sanborn, he was a key member of the second wave of American video artists, which included Bill Viola, Dara Birnbaum, and Tony Orsler. Sanborn's body of work spans the early days of experimental video art in the 70s, and then goes through the heyday of MTV music videos and interactive art to the digital media art of today. Mary Perillo worked with John Sanborn on many projects for PBS. Mary Perillo actually worked on Sesame Street too as a producer, which is kind of a fun little tidbit. And they both worked together on the PBS series Alive from Off Center, which some of y'all might remember. It was an American arts anthology series which aired between 1985 and 1996. And this video, titled Untitled, with Bill T. Jones, was on that series. Bill T. Jones is an African-American dancer, director, and author. And in the video we're about to watch, he is the person who is featured. In the video, he choreographed his own movements, and they're juxtaposed with intermittent, thoughtful declarations of spoken word. This performance is a tribute to his longtime partner, Arnie Zane, who died of AIDS in 1988. Together, they owned the Bill T. Jones and Arnie Zane Dance Company in New York City. So in the video, Jones calls out, "Do you remember?" while a parade of ghostly photographs overlay his image. And by 1995, AIDS was the single greatest killer of men 25 to 44 years old. So it's really something that is important to address in this decade. Another little interesting fact that I found out while I was researching Bill T. Jones is that he's currently married to Bjorn Amelon, and they were married in 1993. Bjorn Amelon helps Bill T. Jones with several of his set designs and other theatrical aspects of his dance performances. And Bjorn Amelon was previously married to Patrick Kelly, the designer, who we have in Fashion Nirvana as well. Patrick Kelly died in 1990 from AIDS as well. All right, now we'll watch the video.
You said a system in collapse is a system moving forward. Do you remember Bill Katz? Do you remember Rodessa? Do you remember Seth? Do you remember Nadine? Do you remember Bobby? Do you remember Eden and Lon? Do you remember Judy? Do you remember Maria? Do you remember Lois? Do you remember Lois? Do you remember Nevelson? Do you remember Willie? Do you remember Keith? Do you remember Juan? Do you remember Longo? You said a system in collapse is a system moving forward. You said a system in collapse is a system moving forward. You said.
Things seem as usual. Bill and I, it appears to be, are moving into a new apartment. Outside, I see many of the people who are working on the construction surrounding this house. And there's a low brick wall, which has been put up very quickly, but very beautifully, and the beginnings of brick pathways, etc.
Okay. Any questions about the first video or thoughts? Or should I move on to the next one? Okay. So the next video that we're going to look at is by Swiss artist Pippolotti Rist. And Pippolotti Rist is best known for creating experiential video art and installation art, which often features herself. Her work is frequently described as surreal, intimate, and having a preoccupation with the female body. It was actually difficult to find one of her pieces from the 90s that didn't have nudity in it. One of the videos that she did was of a woman giving birth. So we went with one that's more family friendly. And so in this video, You Called Me Jackie, Pippolotti Rist is lip-syncing to a 1970s song by English musician Kevin Coyne. Wrist superimposes footage of herself miming with exaggerated gestures and occasionally flubbing the lyrics over fleeting images seen from the window of a moving train. Using popular low-cost techniques then emerging in music videos, Wrist explores the ways musicians aim to create ambiance and a sense of raw authenticity. About music videos, Wrist said, "I have the greatest respect for some MTV clips, since they have a power of innovation and a spirit of discovery that really surpasses video art." And a fun fact about Pipolotti Wrist is that she's designed concert stages, directed videos for local bands, and she's also played in a band herself. She often utilizes songs in other videos that she makes as well, and has done several other videos where she's lip-syncing the lyrics to a song like this one.
You call me Jackie, I call you Edna, sitting in the green all day, laughing at the paper hats we made. White sea wall, burning house, sitting round the table, your sister, mother, brother, and little boy. Now I'm so lonely, just a picture of you. Stuck up in my bedroom, everywhere I go I think of you. Why can't we go on, darling, like we did before? Life should be ever open, ever open door. Now I'm so lonely, lost and all alone. They say you're married with children of your own. Call me Jackie, the white seagulls around, cell breaking, water sound. A big arcade, some noise inside. Seeing you drip down the pier, oh how your great skirts glide. You know it's right, you can't be wrong.
All right. Any, yes?
What kind of date is that?
That was her in the video. And the date of that video is 1990, so right at the start of the decade. Any other questions? Okay. Our next video, which you can see a little sneak peek right here on the screen. Oh, yes. Oh, with the previous video by Pipolotti Wrist?
The decade that we're focusing on, or is it?
So it's the decade that we're focusing on, and then also, for example, like with the Pipolotti Wrist music video, music was such a big part of the 90s, and that was part of the reason that we wanted to include a soundtrack in the space. So many of the designers were influenced by musicians of the period, and we wanted to represent a fuller picture of the 1990s. So in order to do that, we wanted to include some nods to music videos, the music industry. The previous video that had Bill T. Jones dancing, it really shows the vibrant New York arts community, which includes the dance community as well. So the next video that we have is by Tony Orsler in collaboration with the band Sonic Youth. Tony Orsler is best known for his innovative integration of video, sculpture, and performance. Some of y'all may have seen his installations at other museums. He often has these sculptural objects that he projects video onto in the form of large eyes or mouths that the eyes will blink, then the mouths move slightly. And they're kind of surreal and unsettling. While studying at the California Institute of Arts, Orsler was influenced by John Baldessari. And then Orsler worked with the band Sonic Youth to create this video. And Sonic Youth was fronted by lead singer Kim Gordon, who was one of the most, and Sonic Youth was one of the most influential rock bands to emerge from the post-punk New York scene of the 80s and 90s. The lyrics and imagery for Tunic Song for Karen, which is this video, focus on the late Karen Carpenter, a 70s singer who tragically died from anorexia. A caricature in many ways of Carpenter's life, this video criticizes the perils of idealized thinness, which was very pervasive in the 1990s, especially within the fashion industry. And my fun fact for this video is that in 1993, Kim Gordon founded and owned a women's streetwear brand called X-Girl, but by 1998, Gordon sold the brand X-Girl to a Japanese company, and the brand was relocated there, and X-Girl is still sold in Japan today. So, yeah, and we'll watch the video. Questions? And that video is from 1990. I don't know if I mentioned that. Yes, Alexis.
Could you speak a little bit about the stuffed animals?
Oh, so the stuffed animals, I don't know much about Karen Carpenter's life, but in my research I did come across that Karen Carpenter loved stuffed animals and had a huge collection of them. And so the stuffed animals were used in this video as a nod to Karen Carpenter's love for stuffed animals.
How was she characterizing women and girls at that time, and how is it connected to our...
In the video here? So this video is really commentary on how in the 1990s, the media and the fashion industry set this idea of thinness as the idealized form of beauty, and this is a critique of that. And so it's supposed to be somewhat humorous and comical in some ways to draw attention to a very serious matter. Yes?
I'm a little confused. I just took a quick peek in there. Mm-hmm. And I had MTV on all the time in the 90s. I was living in mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, like, is there a name for this style, or...
Sherry, are you talking about fashion, or are you talking about...
I'm talking about the videos, and
So this this video is the only video that we have in the exhibition that was on MTV. And so it was done in collaboration with the band Sonic Youth. The previous video that we watched by Pipolodi Wrist is a video art piece where she's taking the form of a music video for inspiration. Yes? So for this particular video with Tony Orsler and Sonic Youth, Tony Orsler is one of the video artists who's worked throughout the decades, but in the 1990s is when he really came into prominence in the art world for his video art. And so you see this collaboration of him working with the band Sonic Youth, and we thought that that was a really interesting conversation to have of the fine line between commercial video, so this video that would have been on MTV for a band, and then also you have an artist behind it.
Can I ask a question to all of the docents? Is there a perception that the videos that you'll see in the gallery are music videos like on MTV? Are some of you thinking that?
No.
Okay. So I just want to clarify the work requires the video art in the gallery or works of video art, not necessarily something commercially produced. Mm-hmm.
Yes, in this one there is some overlap between MTV music video and video art piece.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment for Sherry. Sherry, when I was doing some of the research for the Thompson style, I found also that they did do pieces about anorexia and other problems as well.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. So the next video that we're going to watch is by Japanese artist Mariko Mori. And Mariko Mori is a multidisciplinary artist. She's known for her contemporary photographs and videos of herself as a hybridized, almost cyborg, futuristic woman. And her work often addresses themes of technology, spirituality, and transcendence. This video, you can see the title on the screen, Miko no Inori, translates to Shaman Girl's Prayer, and it's set in a modified version of Osaka's International Airport, featuring a vaulted temple-like ceiling and futuristic structure. Mori dresses in an iridescent costume, and she can be seen in this video cradling a glass sphere. And she's meant to resemble, I might pronounce this wrong, but a bodhisattva, which is a spiritual guide who forgoes nirvana, which is a state of perpetual happiness, and also in the title of the exhibition, out of compassion for those who suffer. Mori also intended to simulate the motions of a model promoting a new product in this video. A fun fact about her, while studying at Bunka Fashion College in Tokyo in the late 80s, Mori worked as a fashion model. So there are many intersections of fashion, commercial culture, and also this idea of futurism in her work. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay, next we have Jim Mendiola's video, which I'll skip through. Okay, any questions about the previous video? Rico Mori? Yes. I'm not 100% sure about that, but from the research that I did, it was because of the design of the interior, and the Osaka International Airport is very futuristic looking. It has a lot of silver fixtures. It also has a vaulted ceiling, which Mori was drawn to because a lot of her work explores these intersections between technology and spirituality. So that temple-like structure, she found inspirational. Yes?
Do we know the inspiration
from the costume? I don't, actually. I know that she said that she wanted to appear almost like a cyborg, a futuristic cyborg. So I don't know if maybe she was looking at like Japanese sci-fi or something to get inspiration for that. In the 90s, we also have Fifth Element that has lots of cool sci-fi costumes. Maybe she was looking at those for inspiration. I don't know. That's a good question. Mm-hmm. Okay, yes?
Do you know what the word means she was saying?
I don't. Okay, and the next video is by Renika Dijkstra, who is a Dutch artist. And since the early 1990s, Dijkstra has produced a complex body of photographic and video work, offering a contemporary take on the genre of portraiture. The minimal contextual details present in her photographs and videos encourage us to focus on the exchange between photographer, or in this case, videographer, and subject, and the relationship between viewer and viewed. In 1994, Dijkstra traveled to Liverpool to make photographs of school children, and she heard at the time that Liverpool had a really great music scene. So before leaving Liverpool, she decided to go to a nightclub that she had researched and she heard was really fun. But there was a line out the door, so she asked her cab driver for a recommendation for a different club. And the cab driver took her to a club called the Buzz Club, which is the title of this video. And at the Buzz Club, she saw these teenagers and young adults that were dancing and just having a really good time. And she was really drawn to it. So she decided to set up a studio in the back of the club with a white backdrop. And she invited the club goers to come in one or two at a time to dance for her. And while she was there, she actually just took photographs of them. And it wasn't until she got back to her studio in Amsterdam that she realized that there was something that was missing from those photographs, that they didn't have the same energy as when she was actually there. So she decided to go back to the Buzz Club a year later and create a video so she could include movement and sound into those portraits. When asked why she prefers to photograph or make videos of adolescents and young adults, Dijkstra stated, "With young people, everything is much more on the surface, all the emotions. When you get older, you know how to hide things." And I think that really comes through in this video that y'all are about to watch.
Thank you.
It's almost hard to watch that video without dancing. Any questions? Yes.
That
I'd say techno, electronic, club music, any of those, kind of, yeah, Eurotech. Okay, and the next video that we're going to watch is from 1997, and it's the most abstract video that we have in the exhibition. This is also one that we position towards the back of the gallery because it does have some flashing images in it. So if anybody is sensitive to flashing lights or might be prone to seizures, I would give a little heads up before taking them over to this video because it can be somewhat intense. This video is by South Korean artist Seung-go Cho, who currently lives and works in New York. And Cho uses digital imaging processing techniques to manipulate simple everyday objects, scenes of the landscape, and he blends them into these highly lyrical sound and image collages. The formal aspects of his videos are closely tied to explorations of how nature is represented through technology. And he also looks at isolation and loneliness while integrating into a culture, landscape, or language other than one's own. So he's looking at his own personal experiences coming from South Korea to the United States. In this video, Rev, he continues his examination of identity within an urban environment, and images of New York City are interspersed with a video of a candle's flame that methodically waves back and forth, and that suggests a private time within the accelerated urban experience. Thoughts? Questions? Okay. Oh, yes. For these videos? Mm-hmm. So the majority of our videos, there are 9 videos in the exhibition, and 4 of them came from Electronic Arts Intermix, which is a video distribution company. And they work directly with artists. They have the artist rights to the video, and they work with the artist to make sure that they receive fair compensation for their videos. So we started there, and they have an online viewing portal. I went through each year of the 90s and watched the videos that they had on there, and then made a selection, and then went to a curatorial team with Kate, Alexis, and Renee, and we looked through tons and tons of videos and then made a short list of the ones that resonated with us. And then we shared that with our bigger curatorial team and with individuals from other departments like marketing and education to get their feedback as well, finally settling at the last nine. The other videos came, one of them, The Buzz Club, is from the Rubel Family Collection, who we've worked with on several loans in the past. And the Mariko Mori video, we borrowed from the artist and Sean Kelly Gallery. So a few different sources, but several of them we worked directly with the artists as well. The next video we worked with Anthony DeCenza, one up on the screen. So that was how we found them. This next video, as I mentioned, is by Anthony DeCenza, and the video is from 1997. It's titled Suspension. And Anthony DeCenza is an interdisciplinary artist who's based in Massachusetts and New York. His work explores the production and distribution systems of mass media and the narratives it generates. This video is assembled from 100 magazine images, and it creates this video montage that deconstructs full-face images of models and celebrities. So as you're watching the video, you might recognize a few faces coming through. Employing a technique of recording and re-recording the same material, DeCenza uses a cut-and-paste approach to simultaneously fragment and then reassemble the faces. Suspension illustrates the breadth of references and sensibilities operating in advertising and mass media, and the subtle ways that viewers' attention is attracted, held, and directed. Also, as we were going through and selecting videos, one of the things that we looked for, as I know Kate has mentioned previously, was videos that you could come in at any moment and understand what's happening. So non-narrative videos that are really captivating wherever you find yourself walking in to. Yes? Oh. It does. It wasn't Brian Eno. I know in doing my research that DeCenza created the music himself for that video, but it does have that similar sound to it. Okay, and the final video that we're going to look at, this video is from the end of our time frame, 2001, and it's by artist Kristen Lucas. The video is called 5 Minute Break, and Kristen Lucas is a media artist who works in video, performance, installation, and she also makes artwork on the internet. Her work explores the impact of technology on humanity, blurring the boundary between humanity and technology. While artist in residence in the North Tower of the World Trade Center, Lucas was given a tour of the building's sub-basement by Port Authority property manager Robert Lynch. 5-minute break, which we're about to watch, is an eerie artifact of that tour. It's dedicated to Lynch, who died in the tower's collapse on September 11th, 2001. And in the video, an animated woman, who's a stand-in for Lucas, roams the sub-basement like a character from a video game, negotiating an underground maze of empty stairwells, faded graffiti, hulking machinery, and discarded trash. Lucas used early 3D animation technology, which we're so used to seeing today, in video games, movies, all of that, but this was really cutting edge when it came out in 2001, to create the avatar in this video. And Lucas was actually Toni Orsler, the artist who worked with Sonic Youth on the other video. She was Toni Orsler's assistant in the 1990s and worked with him on several projects. By the early 2000s, when she made this video, she was really an established artist in her own right and no longer working with Orsler, but it is an interesting connection between those two artists in the exhibition. And Lucas currently works at the University of Texas at Austin, and she teaches studio art and transmedia. Any questions on, yes?
As a giver of adult tours, mm-hmm. I'm a little bit, befuddled about dealing with this art to make it relevant to people over 30.
Is there a question that we have with the educator from Boston?
Unfortunately, it was out of town.
Okay, so one of the things that she talked about was trying your group before you approach the work of art.
Yes, she had some really great tour ideas. And I think also that you'll be surprised when people walk into the space. I think just the large-scale projections with moving images, we're so used to seeing screens nowadays and moving images that people understand it. Just by walking up and seeing it, they know how to interact with it. And they might need help from you on what is the content? Why is this here? Why am I looking at it? But in general, people are very receptive to video art and moving images. Yes?
I was just wondering, could we get just a list of these video artists and the names? Because I think right now the gallery just checklist just says videos.
Oh, the checklist that the docent should have, it does have all of the video artists listed. So first it goes by fashion, and then at the end of the checklist we have art, and the video art is on there. There are also clips from the videos. I'll also pull together, some of these videos are available to view online. Not all of them, but some of them are. So I can make a list that has links to those videos so that you all can watch them at home or a place more comfortable than standing in the gallery with the headphones on.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Any other questions? Yeah.